I'm really excited to be able to moderate this thing. I think over the last 10 years, I have spent a lot of time in the skilled nursing industry, the nursing home industry. I helped start up an institutional special needs program. I was the chief medical officer. And as we strove to get network adequacy, I was knocking on the door of hospital CEOs, their network programming folks, and their trying to convince them that they wanted to take our plan, ProCare Advantage. And I remember knocking on these doors and saying, hey, I've got 50 patients that I want to have treated in your hospital. Please take our plan. And the hospital CEO, 50,000 patients, that's awesome. And I was like, no, it's 50. And they don't actually all live in your county. So it was such a struggle, and it took us a long time to get network adequacy for this plan. But that is exactly what I'm stressing here. Like, everything that we are doing here takes time and takes planning. And that's why I'm really excited to speak with everybody up here, because they've got such a wealth of knowledge. I mean, we've got like half a century of knowledge up here in dealing with C-SNPs and I-SNPs and MAs. And so that's really what I'm excited to bring to you here this morning. So James, let me kind of throw out the first question to you. Medicare Advantage penetration has nationally eclipsed 50% in most major areas. How are we seeing this represented within the walls of private pay senior housing?
Yeah, great question. And as to everybody, thanks this morning again for the time, and great conference so far. So let's keep it up. I think when we think about what's happening from a benefit perspective in your communities, the best assumptions that I can provide are in the lower socioeconomic communities, those where your residents are dually eligible or shortly soon to be, we tend to see a better blend of Medicare Advantage. So in some of those communities, you might even already have more than 50% of your residents on an MA product or a managed care plan. The other 50%, or you know, just shy of that, might be on straight Medicare with a supplement. The increase I've tended to see in your rental rates that goes up, you start to see the scale go the opposite direction. And so in many communities where it's a pure private play community or private pay community, you might see upwards of 75% of your residents still on Medicare with a supplement, which means only 25% might have Medicare Advantage. And obviously there's, you know, certain markets and states and counties where there might be some difference there, but generally speaking, many of the pure private pay seniors housing, you know, buildings where your rental revenues eclipse $4,000 or $5,000 a month, you're still gonna predominantly see Medicare be the lion's share of your residents in the community.
Excellent. So now we understand how prevalent the MA is within the walls of the private pay senior housing community. Jeremy, when you're thinking about starting or joining a health plan, what are some of the important considerations or words of advice?
Yeah, and maybe I'll spend 30 seconds explaining how Medicare actually Advantage works and how you actually get paid to answer Alan's question. So Medicare establishes at a county level a benchmark rate that says the average Medicare beneficiary in, you know, this county, in this state, Miami-Dade County, X amount of dollars average Medicare beneficiary. And then from there, they do demographic adjustments and risk adjustments. So demographics are your age, your sex, and income as dual, are you dual eligible or non-dual as a proxy. And then they look at your chronic conditions. And they're called HCCs, or that's what we refer to as risk adjustment. And so the higher the acuity, the more chronic conditions you have, there's a multiplication factor back to that county rate that then establishes your base premium. And if you can spend total cost of care less than that base premium, that's how you generate value-based care, right? And so when you look in the senior population, we talked a lot yesterday about avoidable hospitalizations. That is the number one thing we focus on 100% in this industry. And it's where the dollars are. It's poor care. We believe putting the dollars well up, well north, well earlier in the system is the way to do it through primary care. And through operators like yourself, we're in an incredible position to deliver outstanding care on a high revenue population. So that's kind of the baseline understanding. So what are some considerations when you're thinking about how to work with a Medicare Advantage plan, or how to even, you know, get into Medicare Advantage? Couple of things I would ask you, and this was kind of prevalent yesterday in the conversation. What are your goals? And I think really being very clear on that is probably a foundational element of, do you look at this as because you're trying to maximize revenue, you just want a piece of the pie? On the other end, are you like, at the end of the day, you really just want to provide the best care possible. You know your residents have a cacophony of supplements and Medicare Advantage plans, and you really want to focus on how do I deliver a more integrated experience? And there's a lot that's in between. So that's kind of the first consideration. Second, I would say is operationally, we also talked a lot about this yesterday at our table. Are you just wanting to say I'm in Medicare Advantage and it's just gonna happen without me, right? I explained how you actually generate income. You have to actually keep people out of the hospital. You have to make sure they're taking the right medications. It really is delivering great upfront primary holistic care. So that's the thing is like, are you really ready to drive change in your organization if your organization isn't there today? The next three things get to more into the financial. What's your scale? And so if you're a operator that's got 24 buildings, you've got thousands of units, you've got a lot of dual eligibles, what model makes sense for you may be very different than a standalone AL and memory care with maybe 100 residents. Third consideration is, what is your risk tolerance? In life, more risk, more reward, right? And so there's definitely, if you're on that smaller end of that spectrum, you might not want to take a lot of risk right away. If you have a massive pool to start with, maybe more risk is more attractive to you. And then finally, access to capital. Again, as we'll talk through this, it's an investment. Like, health plans are extremely expensive to run, but they scale. They scale very, very rapidly. So there's this amount of, you have to treat this as an investment of some level. How much investment you want to put in is going to be sort of dictated by which path you want to choose. But I think those, to me, those are like the five things that if I were in your all shoes, I'd be thinking about if what's my best vehicle here. I would take those five things into consideration.
That's excellent, excellent advice. I think it's kind of interesting, the four of us up here on stage, I don't know if you heard in our bios, we're all previous or current United Healthcare employees.
You can see because we all have ties on. That's how you know that.
And United, really, they have a path towards being your own MA or being your own C-SNP, and it always starts with kind of that introduction of how do you coordinate care. So being in an ACO, being in an MSSP, that's where it kind of foundationally starts. So just like you were saying, like, you don't want to be a facility that has 100 patients and saying, oh, we're going to start a C-SNP tomorrow. I don't think that's actually ever going to work. So very good points there. Jennifer, as you think about everything that's been said so far, what additional thoughts do you have on why would you want to start up your own MA plan?
Yeah, so I think my provider-owned plan, there's two reasons they wanted to start this plan. One was to have a seat at the table, to be paid for the quality of care that they were providing for their residents and not seeing that reimbursement. Two, making a change in the senior housing and being able to use those supplemental benefits in the benefit design to go to their communities. So every year that I bring my providers together, that's one of the most exciting times of the year to look to see what do these residents need they're not getting from traditional Medicare today, or even some of the Medicare Advantage plans that could help the communities and the residents. We talked about the love meter yesterday, and we added last year a companion care. I mean, if you can't find the volunteers for these residents that aren't being seen, use that companion care benefit. You know, that would help with even the memory care folks. Things like that, you know, transportation. I heard a group yesterday talk about transportation and the struggles there. You know, be reimbursed for your own transportation and the things that you are doing in your communities. And I can go on and on. Another thing with some of our CCRCs is giving the residents a choice of flex dollars. So bringing those dollars back to be able to spend in the community to help offset maybe beauty or fitness, or, you know, the other things that are being done that, you know, maybe rising rates with inflation and the rent. So this is why they wanted a seat at the table and to truly be able to run their own Medicare plan.
Excellent, excellent. I totally agree with that. James, when you think about the average senior living resident, why would she choose MA versus staying on Medicare with a supplement?
Yeah, great question. I think folks find themselves making that decision really at different times in their life. Obviously, you know, seniors that age into Medicare at 64 and a half are starting to make decisions at a very different time in their life than the time in which they need to make decisions maybe at 80 or 85 when they're moving into your communities. I think what typically tends to happen is people are debating between price and network. What can I afford versus who is going to give me and provide me this care? And those things kind of fluctuate in the patient's decision-making tree. What I think ends up needing to be deciphered around that 85-year-old age range is, if I'm still on Medicare and I stayed on Medicare with a supplement plan because I could afford it and I wanted this vast unlimited network that is Medicare's, am I really able to access that vast unlimited network anymore? Do I still want to go to any specialist? Do I still want to go to any hospital? Or am I at a stage in my life where cost matters and I could be reinvesting that $400 plus that I pay in premiums into my community and my living scenario, which I would now save if I joined a Medicare Advantage plan? And does the Medicare Advantage plan have such a curated network that's important to me at this phase of my life? And what the panelists up here do so phenomenally well is work with operators to make sure that your preferred ancillary vendors and specialists are those that shine within their directory. And that way, the resident, we hope, doesn't have to make a really tough decision when deciding to choose MA. It's sort of the obvious decision at that point. And again, I support ACO businesses, I support Medicare Advantage businesses, so I really don't have a dog in this fight. But I think that that's what most of your residents should be considering, as opposed to, oh my gosh, I was looking at my television last night at 11 p.m. and saw Joe Namath tell me about this amazing deal out there right now. Because we're getting ready to have that same time of year, right? Annual enrollments upon us. That occurs between October 15th and December 7th every year. And this is where these Medicare Advantage plans start to fill the airwaves and your residents' mailboxes with leaflets and literature. And buyer beware, there's a lot of, you know, interesting marketing materials out there. Your residents should turn to you. They should be asking you questions because you are that trusted advisor, as Coach brought up several times yesterday. And I think we also have to come to the time where you don't shy away from being that trusted advisor. I hear many communities really stray away from talking to residents about plan choice, primary care choice, benefit choice. I think our residents that move into our communities, they're moving in because they need an advisor, they need a navigator, and they're turning to you and not looking for sort of, you know, a hands-off approach. I think they're actually looking for a keen understanding of the complex system we're in today.
That's so true. I mean, I think as you create a Medicare Advantage network, you are looking at the residents within your facility and who they utilize as physicians and specialists, and that's who you have in network. And you do that because there isn't a whole lot of transparency within the care delivery world about outcomes, but you know them. You may know them anecdotally, but you do have a decent N in your research. It's not N of one of like, oh, I went to this physician and he wouldn't give me pain medication, so I don't like him. You actually have reliable data to determine, well, this particular physician had this many returns to acute, so maybe that he's not really concentrating on keeping people out of the hospital. So that is the one of the benefits, I think, in developing your own MA plan, is you can concentrate on picking the providers within your community that actually deliver excellent results. So obviously later today there's going to be a discussion about ACOs. This morning obviously we're talking about Medicare Advantage plans. The nice thing about having all these subject matter experts up here is that there are multiple ways to set up an MA plan. So Jeremy, can you go over a couple of those?
Yeah, so if you sort of walk through my 5 points earlier, sort of it can put yourself into kind of one of, I would say, three models, which Curana happens to operate in all three varieties. So if you're a big operator, you're sophisticated, you've got scale, you've got capital, one option is you start your own health plan. And that means putting up a few million dollars in regulatory capital, It means putting up a few million dollars to invest in the technology and claim systems and customer service and all of those things that you need to do to actually run a health plan. And so that would be sort of, and then even in that, there's sort of two ways to go about that. You can partner with somebody like myself, or you can partner with like an AHP or something like that. But really it's, you know, you can partner and like we do a Medicare in the box solution, or you can try and build it piecemeal. And I would strongly encourage nobody to do that, to start your own plan piecemeal. Running these things are extraordinarily complex, highly regulated, as you guys can certainly appreciate. And trying to navigate a bunch of point solutions in a very complex environment that you're not familiar with, I don't think is a recipe for success. So if you want to own your own health plan, I certainly would at least start with a partner that really that can really bring to you a comprehensive set of solutions. Sort of the next variant down that is maybe you don't have quite as much scale, but you want to be investment, you want ownership. A JV is another great option. So, you know, we are a minority partner in Perennial's plan as one example. Three of the four board members though, they're operators. We've got one board seat. They run the plan. We help them. And so they're, you know, finding again the right partner that can bring to you the capabilities to help ensure your success and can be a great partner, but still give you ownership as a part of that deal. And you have got mutually aligned incentives. So that's another great option we see. And then third, which I'd kind of say is more like you're putting your toe in the water. Maybe you don't have a lot of scale. You can join an existing Medicare Advantage plan or institutional special needs plan. And just to use that jargon, an I-SNP or an IE-SNP just means you qualify for a long-term level of care. And the plan limits its enrollment to those who qualify for long-term care. So in that regard, so like this, for us, this would be like our Alliance Senior Care plan. We fully own it, we run it, we put all the capital up, but then we would execute a value-based care deal that would say like, look, if we collectively can reduce hospitalizations together, I remember sort of the ROI analysis we saw on the board yesterday, we do the exact same exercise, and then we establish whether it's admissions rates or other quality metrics, say, look, if we hit these things together, we're going to share X amount of dollars back with you. So that's a very low risk. You know, if things don't go to plan, you're not putting money out, you're not putting things back in. But in return, you're not a true owner. You're coming together with maybe a variety of other payer, other partners in that environment. So I think really at the end of the day, there's a solution for everybody, depending upon what you want to do. And sometimes we even talk about people graduating. So maybe they start, they just put their toe in the water, they see some good results, and they want a bigger piece of the pie. Well, then maybe a JV now is the next good option for you. And so so we've seen people kind of move through that process as well. So I think there's not necessarily a right or wrong, or one's better than the other. It really comes down to when you think about those first five things I mentioned, where do you kind of fit in that bucket? If you don't got a few million dollars laying around, starting your own health plan is probably not your first option. But if you want ultimate control, you've got the scale, you want to co-brand it with your own, you know, the name of your communities. Like, so NHC is another partner of ours, NHC Advantage is the name of their health plan, right? So kind of depends on what you want to do, but there's options for everybody.
That's a great explanation, I think. As you look at, you know, having to invest $3.5-4 million, that's a big chunk of change and a huge decision to make. You know, it's interesting too, you have to think about kind of what the opportunity is. The average Medicare member right now is probably what, about $900 PMPM, so you're looking at about $7,000 to $8,000 PMPM. But you know, if you have a more complicated community, the end-stage renal disease patients, you know, they're $9,000 PMPM and mm-hmm. potentially $70,000 to $80,000 on a yearly basis. So there is revenue there, and it can make sense.
In translation, PMPM is health plan lingo for per member per month.
Sorry. Mm-hmm. There's also PMPY. Yeah. thank you for that, James. So Jennifer, as you've listened to Jeremy here talking about kind of the different options, if you're doing a JV, why join an MA plan with like-minded providers?
Yeah, so Perennial Advantage, back in 2019, Larry Gamina brought into his boardroom like-minded providers, mission-driven providers that had the same want for their members, and brought everybody around the boardroom and gave the presentation, this is what we want to do, this is where we want to get it off the ground, let's lock arms and let's do this. I'm impressed with how well it turned out. I came in 2021 when the plan had started, and they had 5 members in Ohio, and since then we've had others come back and knocking on the door saying, okay, COVID, we did this during COVID, COVID's over, let's talk further about a Medicare Advantage plan. But I think when you're thinking about doing this, we talked yesterday about sharing values, and I think we hit this subject yesterday. I think that's what you're looking for, sharing those same values and the same goals for your residents with those partners.
So James, when you talk about the financial benefits to a facility, to what extent should senior housing staff be aware of the payer mix in their building? How does that matter?
It was touched on yesterday. I mean, oftentimes when we partner with communities, the first thing we sort of do is try to get down to the bedrock. You know, what is the payer mix, so to speak, of the residents in the community? It still surprises me to this day that the buildings don't always know. And it might be that, you know, somebody hands, you know, me a blinded sort of anonymized booklet of face sheets and we're flipping through pages together. But as you all probably can speak to, these face sheets are often as dated as the resident's tenure in your community, so that we hope is a couple years old, and they could have since switched plans. So I think it's incredibly important. I know one of the speakers yesterday mentioned that, you know, one of my cheats that we've developed over the years is to work with your long-term pharmacy partner, because they know and they have that most accurate information, because they're billing and collecting your insurance, mm-hmm. the resident's insurance, on a monthly basis usually. So getting to an understanding of kind of what the payer mix in your community is, part of that like table stakes exercise that Jeremy so eloquently established in the 5-point framework. It's also important because you might already have scale and density with an MA payer in your building and you just don't know it. So we're up here talking about a couple of very customizable MA solutions. But remember, as Bob also discussed yesterday, there's a lot of eyeballs on your space from not just CMS, but from the Medicare Advantage plans as a whole. And that might sound silly, because I know I took kind of a cheap shot at Kaiser yesterday, but there's a lot of the big 5 payers in your markets that you might have a lot of Aetna patients or Humana patients or United patients already in your campus. And do you know the network managers of those major insurers? They might like to know you, and they might care to know that you've got 30 or 40 or 50 of their members on one campus, and they might want to appreciate the fact that you all are doing a good job at cost containment and inpatient avoidance and quality adherence and the things you're doing and the extents you're going for your members, your residents. So those are just some exercises that I think matter, and it also is going to matter for the downstream partners that you bring into your building. So again, back to the network and the San Antonio Spurs team that you're developing in each of your communities. If a bunch of your residents on your campus, you know, are with a Humana, but yet your preferred home health agency doesn't contract with Humana, your long-term care pharmacy doesn't contract with Humana's PBM, you might be setting your team up for sort of an ineligible player, if that makes sense. And so you have to be mindful that all these things are at play, and if you're really setting up your community for a nice resident experience and ecosystem amongst the partners you're putting together, that's probably more reason than anything else to really know the payer mix in your building and kind of what you're thinking about doing next.
Clinical integration.
That's my answer from my stripe of the beach ball there for our New Perspectives team that speaks in that language.
Excellent analogies, thanks. So Jeremy, what should an operator look for in a partner?
Yeah, I think of a couple of things, and I think we've heard a lot of it today and yesterday. So first I would say alignment of mission, vision, and values. So I think fundamentally you want the same end goal and be aligned on how your organizations can work together. There are different players in this space. There's other companies that do what I do. And oftentimes people we're working with, they're talking to all of us. And so I think just making sure that you really are feeling like you can work with, you can have transparency with that partner, and you can be really partners. So like with with Perennial Advantage as an example, like, yeah, we get highly customized in the benefit package, and Perennial does some super innovative things about not just looking at I can take dollars on the back end of delivering great care, I can take front end dollars and put it into my communities and have benefits and more care delivered right on site. So having a partner that sort of is aligned with you around that, willing to be flexible, I think is something that's really important. Next, I would talk about just operational sophistication, right? So running a Medicare Advantage plan is a highly complex thing. You have to have a state insurance license, and then you need to get approved by CMS to do it. So you're subject to two different regulators. You have to be able to manage a soup to nuts insurance company, which is just in today's day and age is extraordinarily, complex. So having somebody that's done it before, has some expertise and can make, kind of give you the easy button, I think is a good consideration. I look at clinical capabilities, and sort of back to that holistic, care model. So we have nurse practitioners, physicians are kind of the core of a great primary care model, and APPs in this environment, that is really the secret sauce. But one thing that we've layered on in a lot of our plans is something we call a care ally. And what the care ally is typically it's a nurse or sometimes a social worker, and their job is to then also bridge the gap between high quality clinical care and holistic person-centered care. So let me give an example of that. So we had a resident who had moved into a senior living setting and was paraplegic and was no longer able to do just basic things they wanted to do. She wanted to read a book, couldn't hold the book to read it. So our care ally, in discussing her goals of care, what did she want to accomplish? She said, I want to be able to read a book. And so, we're not going to be able to address her paraplegism, but we can get her other ways to enjoy the things in life she wants. So our care ally went to the library, got her a library card, found her a CD player, got her a pair of headphones, and got her the book on CD that she wanted. And so I think it's those sorts of things in the organizations that are thinking about care, not just what's the best sort of evidence-based medicine, which is hugely important, but what is really that end consumer want? And so finding an organization that kind of has the capabilities to do that and is sort of like-minded with you is I think really, really key. And then I just kind of wrap it up with, the access to data, the technology, data without context is kind of irrelevant. So I can tell you all, the University of Minnesota is 10th all time in national championships in college football. Sounds amazing, must be a powerhouse. The context is that was in the 1930s, right? And so you have to be able to have an organization that's got, the right mission, the right vision, the right partnership approach, has the capabilities, and then is able to bring you data and solutions and contextualize it for you so that you can actually really drive better outcomes.
Excellent. Excellent. Well, so we've hit the zeros on the shot clock here. I think I want to wrap things up a little bit. You've probably heard kind of throughout the community, you're seeing stuff on CNN and Fox about the headwinds that Medicare Advantage has ahead of it. And they're for real. So I don't want to downplay those, but I will say that the particular communities that you have do operate different than traditional Medicare and traditional MA. So while it's important to listen to what's actually happening in the future that's up here is different, and the opportunities still exist. And so I would encourage you all to, as leadership teams, continue to think about what the options are here. And I'll invite Coach up here to take us on to the group participation.
Thank you, guys. That was incredible. So I'm going to make a slight, audible here. In so doing, I'm going to switch it up. We're going to still have the table talk, right? So get with your table. That's going to be 15 minutes. I think there's going to be a lot of questions out there about MA plans, right? And we've got some really good experts here about MA plans, right? So I want to leave a little bit longer time for Q&A.
Well, Jennifer, I was hoping you could just reiterate the conversation we just had about the power of coming together as a team and regionalizing that and how can we make that work in simple terms?
Sure. So the question he had asked was, if we have a multitude of states, so we have four or five different states with buildings in each state, in your shoes now, where do you go? Do you want to start your own plan? Do you want to get a consortium of providers together to go to those different states? Or do you want to try the Medicare Advantage plans that are available today in the states that are available? Those are some choices that you all have today. And I know Jeremy spoke on that a little bit. One of the last questions I was going to get to was start your own plan or join another. What are the pros and cons of doing those? You know, capital is the huge requirement. The state capital is very expensive to start your own plan. Experience, not having the experience of starting a plan. You're gonna have to come up with your own model of care, you know, through CMS. Or do you join a plan that already has a model of care built that you can look at the outcomes today and how they're performing? So you definitely have options out there. It's just thinking on, do you wanna do your own or do you wanna join ones that are already have some experience?
Other questions? Questions in the from the audience, just raise your hand and I'll come around to you. One question I had was maybe if you could talk a little bit about, I know that you got really into it as far as like care coordination fees. How do care coordination fees work for an individual operator if they were simply looking to partner, dip their toe in? What does a care coordination fee look like and what is it?
You want me to go?
Yeah.
Okay. So the care coordination fee is actually essentially paying you back for the care that you guys are all providing today. So that is built into a per member per month in your contract that you're meeting those model of care requirements, kind of talking about the care ally, like Jeremy talked about, we have what we call a medical concierge. So helping those residents schedule their appointments, doing health risk assessments, capturing those changing conditions before they go to the hospital. Those are all things that CMS will approve and the DOIs will approve in the state that we can actually reimburse you immediately a per member per month revenue back to your plan.
Yeah, I mean, it's one of the things we talked about yesterday, just staffing, being overwhelmed, and how am I gonna do yet another thing? And well, it's an opportunity. It's like, well, we do this right, there can actually be enough revenue to get a part-time person who does some of this or get a full-time person that works on this to drive the things you're talking about. So I think the right partner that understands the industry and what you're actually capable of doing is going to work with you on an incentive agreement that should give you the ability up front to make some investments and then still share some savings at the end of the day if we can, you know, deliver great outcomes.
It might be helpful to let them know kind of what the range of payments on a PMPM basis would be.
Yeah, I think we see anywhere from $25 to $100 to $125, depending on the level of care. So that's something else, because if you're looking at your SNF, you're obviously getting much more reimbursement on your Part A, your Part B, you know, and your care coordination payments, where if you're in assisted living or independent living, you're not seeing those reimbursements come back. So that care coordination fee can help for those resident services and, you know, those that are doing those services today.
Why that matters too. So by the way, the big health plans probably wouldn't be offering something like this. This is something
right.
That more nimble, I'd say enculturated type plans that really understand your space offer. But that is like the lightest, loosest way to start to reimburse yourself for things you're already doing. So this isn't mean you add more staff to achieve the $20 to $100 PMPM. This means that they're knowing that you're doing things for them that are lifting their stars rating and lifting their risk adjustment and decreasing their cost of care. And they're going to pay you in advance in a non-risked way. So that's just money that's headed your way. Now, at that PMPM multiplied by how many members are on their platform, it's not going to make you rich, and it's certainly not going to make them poor, but it will help along the way when you add it up over a couple hundred residents in a few buildings. I mean, that's $60,000 to $100,000 over the course of this year. That might be paying for a couple of your staff members for stuff you're already doing.
Yeah. All right, Jim.
When you think of the care coordination piece, what's the time frame for that reimbursement as far as like once you get the agreement going, and then what's the time frame when that kicks in?
You get it every month, you would get the check. So it's a per member per month. It would be on the effective date of when you enroll the members into the plan. So once you start that membership enrollment, you would start getting the monthly reimbursement.
It's not 2 years from now.
That's going to be the next conversation on the yep. ACOs is the shared savings two years from now.
So my question is not a question. It's just, can you clarify the flow of funds as it relates to the I-SNP or the IE-SNP and the facility? So the facility has residents, some are private pay. If it's a skilled, you have Medicare that's paying, you know, that really is the revenue source for the operator. And then on the plan, they get the capitated payment. So when you look at the flow of funds, how much of that capitated payment goes to the facility on, and I think you just touched on that, the care coordination fee is part of the revenue of the facility. And then, you know, then down the line, if there's shared savings, that gets, could, you know, distributed to them. So I kind of want to see like a clear understanding, you know, I want to understand more clearly how the flow of fund works to the plan and to the facility in terms of their revenue.
Do you want to take that?
Go ahead.
It's a good question. So I think it's also important to understand it differs between truly SNF long-term care than senior living. So in the long-term care population, the Medicare Part A and Part B patients, obviously the skilled nursing facility is providing things like Part A covered stays, and sometimes you know, providing the therapy. They're actually hands-on physically providing billable services to Medicare. So the reimbursement model for a nursing home or a cohort of a nursing home in a bigger portfolio is going to look different than what it would look like in senior living, simply because typically senior living are not actually providing Medicare billable services, right? So just to give you an example, and in the interest of transparency, you know, I'd say on a long-term care eligible, you're looking at about $2,500 to $3,000 per member per month that comes into the health plan. And out of that $2,500 to $3,000 a month, highly variable though, like some will be much lower, some will be much less, you know, so much higher. That's what we have to fund all of operations, to fund all of the clinical care that happens, not just in your building, but in the hospital, in the community, transportation, podiatry. I mean, anything that is covered by the plan is gonna come out of that premium dollar. So if you're a nursing home, typically we see average costs, again, on a per member per month, averaging them out of about roughly $500 between Medicare Part A and Medicare Part B. So you'd sort of start with that as roughly a baseline payment. It doesn't have to be capitated. It doesn't have to be done in an upfront per member per month basis when you're talking about original Medicare covered services. We do have parties that love capitation. They love the idea of it. They want capitation because if they can also beat their capitation, they're making margin off the capitation. Others, again, that's a step too far. It's a toe into risk management. And they just say, look, I just want to bill original Medicare. I just want you to pay me like I was original Medicare. And then let's add on the care coordination fee, or let's add on a shared savings at the end of the day. Senior living, because there is not a financial sort of responsibility between the health plan and the community to reimburse the community for things like skilled nursing care typically or therapy typically, that's kind of the model where Jen described, where you're still the nexus of care coordination. You're still the one that sees people today, and that's not a billable Medicare service. So what we do is we get around that with the care coordination fees. And so that's where we're saying, look, I think, you know, Jim, you pointed out very well. I mean, it's actually, you know, I describe it as hiring more staff, but to your point, a lot of it is just getting paid for stuff you're probably already doing today. That's where you're gonna just have your upfront payment to say, look, you're doing these great things, you're checking out on the resident, you've invested in some of these technologies, you're tracking visitors and UTIs. Great, let's give you some compensation up front to offset that cost of technology, offset some of the clinical innovations you've brought. And then on the back end, you know, typically there's a variety of models. There's some where there's sort of metrics driven on quality measures and star ratings and how many members are adherent to medications. You can get highly technical, or you can be much, much simpler, which is, like, how often did people go out to the hospital? And what point are we generating savings by having less hospitalizations? And then we split that savings is another kind of really typical model. So I'm trying so hard not to get technical right now, and it's really hard for me. So if at any point, you know, now or afterwards, if you're like, I just didn't get that, can you walk me through it again? Mm-hmm. I'm happy to do that. I just love talking about this stuff, and so I'm just trying really hard not to, like, go down into the real technical details of how this stuff works.
Well, and I think James brought up a comment earlier today when we're talking about cash flow. It's not always to the plan. Some plans do lose money that they ended up, you know, having to pay back to CMS. So there is risk in this. Like, it's not all gravy.
Yeah, there's no guarantees, right? I mean, there's some downside risk. So got another question
just
right here.
Really quickly, too. I think the one thing that's worth calling out is, you know, that there is such a thing as shared losses. So we talked a lot yesterday and today about shared savings, and it's fun to talk about shared savings, and it's fun to see your residents, members to plans, flourish. It really is. If we're coding them correctly, we're getting the correct revenue top line, and then we're, of course, delivering on proactive preventive care that keeps them out of those high-dollar settings. But this also hits the note that we talked about in the first half of the session, which is, what is your risk tolerance, and how ready are you to be a change agent in your community? Because if you're just thinking you're going to sign a deal, get a little bit of a care coordination fee, but not have to also spend time and effort getting residents to sign up for this service or changing your operation to, in fact, decrease this avoidable cost of care, then there's going to be potentially shared losses if that's the type of arrangement you're after as well. So I don't think that should be where we focus our time, but it is just still something to be aware of.
My question is more about, you know, we can talk about the revenue stream that we're going to bring back by taking on these plans, but I want to know, is there impact or focus on the comorbidities? So if they have CHF or they have COPD and we're working extra hard for that person based on their diagnoses, and we are spending extra time with that individual based on somebody else that doesn't have those complexities, you need to be looking at that too, so you know what your reimbursements are, because they shouldn't be the same from resident to resident. Mm-hmm. And so maybe talk a little bit more about that for people that, you know, haven't had that experience or exposure for in regards to your plans.
Risk scores.
Want me to start? Yeah.
Go ahead.
So CMS manages that dynamic through risk adjustment and risk scores, which is what I kind of opened with. And so, yes, the plan or the insurance company or even the ACO, which we'll talk about, you know, next, their revenue is at a per member level. It is unique to that individual. And it's precisely because somebody with multiple comorbidities or who's on dialysis is going to generally spend far more money than somebody who's healthy and golfing on the weekends, right? And so that happens at the plan level. When you get down to the community level, there's a couple of ways you can do that. I mean, if you're actually more invested in the risk side, you can look at things like percent of premium. And so it actually then just flows right through, right? All the premium that comes at health plan, you take a percentage of that premium and sort of it's risk adjusted at the population health level. The other way you can look at it is you can do the care coordination fees, and you sort of say, well, what is the average sort of investment and time I'm putting in? And again, this is where we look at this, like, as a payer at a pop health level. It's not for me to say, well, it's to sort of get out of that fee for service type of mentality where this person's sicker, so I'm gonna do more stuff, so I'm gonna get paid for more stuff. It's saying, like, look, this is what the cost it is to deliver care in this community. How do we offset that cost of care? And then you guys and the clinicians decide who needs the most attention and who is okay with maybe a weekly check-in or a monthly visit, right? And so there's different ways to do it depending upon, you know, kind of where you're at and how to set it up. But that's kind of how I think about it.
Yeah. And just thinking about this, we're getting super technical. When we run a plan, you guys have the data. So with my partners, they see monthly data on their members that are going to the hospital. We work with risk adjustment teams, back to your point, every single month. So our clinicians are looking at the gaps. We're looking to close those gaps on those members where we know we need to hit those higher risk adjustments. So this stuff is being looked at. You get quarterly business reviews. You're seeing us in the buildings on a monthly basis. So yes, you're running your own plan, but we also give you the tools to run your own plan. You're not going in here blindly going, I hope, worried about the downside. Oh, you know, I'm a couple months in, I see my claims run out. You know, it's not looking very good. You know, let's take a look at this. So yes, it's risk adverse, but if you manage it and you have the tools to manage it, you can be very successful.
One question came through here and then we'll go to Murray. So a question is an ACO a good first step or option to get comfortable working in value-based care? Will it set you up for success in MA?
I think it's a good stepping off point. I mean, as I look at what United does with their partners out in the community, that's generally where we plug people in and they're dipping their toe in. It allows you to hire the staff necessary to collect the data, to manage the patients, to do the care coordination. In a way, hopefully, that will start you out with just shared savings, and there is no downside to it. So hopefully you're successful and we give you some extra money, and the loss to y'all is having hired that staff and then not meeting your expectations. But that's a great way to start. Mm-hmm. So yes, I think that is. I don't know if the panel has a different opinion.
I think about it a similar way, but you know, from our perspective, Curana, we do both, right? And so we get back to what you opened with, which is roughly half the people are in original Medicare and half are in some Medicare Advantage solution. So if you starting ACO is a much less complex overall, it's not an insurance company, it's a much less complex thing, it is an easier thing to step into. The trade-off with that is you are almost by definition eliminating half of your residents from any opportunity to drive savings or to share in what Humana and United and what everybody else is doing. So I think that's why for us, you know, we support wherever people are on that journey, but we look at it as like, well, like, look, do you wanna go have a solution for 100% of your residents or do you want a solution that's gonna be 50%? Because, and the reason I say that is because if you're in a Medicare Advantage plan, by definition, you are not eligible to be in an ACO. Because CMS considers a Medicare Advantage plan already an accountable value-based care vehicle. So you can't be in both at the same time. So that's our perspective, but I'd say if you want to get down to just like, well, what's the easiest way to get started? I think ACO is not a bad option at all.
And remember, value-based tenets of success are the same in both.
Yeah.
So if you are good at one, in theory, you've built the chassis to be good in another. The thing I love about ACOs is the member eligibility side and the work on switching the patient to a plan is somewhat avoided. Yeah. So many of your residents will see an easier glide path to joining an ACO.
All right, no pressure, Murray. Last question.
Oh, is there another question over there?
I'm teeing you.
Say
Joelle.
Oh. how impactful is service coordination and documentation to what you just talked about, Jennifer?
Yeah, so model of care, you know, is pretty strict, obviously. So if we get audited by CMS, we do have to have our model of care documentation. So our care plans, ICT meetings, all of those things that we follow with our model of care is definitely, but that's something that we do manage on the clinical side. So we have our preferred clinical group to come in. And if we're doing ACO, primary care plan, do it all together. We're documenting, we're getting it all in. Managing those risk scores, it's monitored, so.
Yeah, if I could just very briefly, quickly add onto that. And so you definitely, so the community cannot document risk scores, right? It has to be a clinician that can bill services that can document risk scores. So having, back to this sort of looking at this as a partnership, having really strong primary care that has the right tools and technology that can, you know, and or support with a health plan, that can actually know what to look for, has the suspecting methodology, serves the data up in a way that the clinicians can understand it, that's where the revenue value is captured outside of the, did we do the right, you know, the right clinical model things? Because at the end of the day, CMS only cares if somebody documents on a claim that you have diabetes. Mm-hmm. So we see people who magically lose diabetes and lose cardiovascular disease 1 year after the next, right? So anyway,
yep.
or time's up.
Yep.
All right. Thank you, guys.